person who have started? Great. So today is the 31st of March 2021 and we are looking at dividends. Okay, so so that is the main aim. Kolo, Kolo, are you with us? Yes, so the aim of the administrator in this case is not primarily asset realization for the purpose of distribution. That is the last purpose that an administrator will look into. That is the least of his intentions. His primary intention, manage.
Revive the company.
And revive. Administrative receivership, manage, sell assets, and pay that man that appointed you. Once you pay the man that appointed you, you don't have any problem with the company, you are off. But in managing for the purpose of asset realization and distribution, the receiver, the receiver manager, the administrative receiver, is likely to trample upon the interests of unsecured creditors as well as the interests of the company and of its members. So by the time he's done with the company, what you have is likely going to be a shell. There will be nothing left. Yes, there will be nothing left in the company. And so invariably, at the end of administrative receivership, the company will go into insolvent liquidation. Because what will be left will be so tiny. And all the persons waiting to be satisfied, the other unsecured creditors, will be so many. Are you with me? Yes. And so the company will go into insolvent liquidation. It was to forestall or to curtail that, that we are now saying, let's bring in the idea of administration. And while in the case of administrative receivership, the administrator, the receiver, or the receiver manager is often, almost always appointed by the floating charge holder, in some cases by the court. With the respect of administrator, we are looking at the directors could appoint,
members
could appoint, yes, the court could appoint, then the floating charge holder could appoint. You know, and we already talked about the effect. Once he's appointed, these other rights are kept in abeyance, and then the moratorium begins to operate. Any other question before we jump
yes,
into
just very quickly,
yes,
sir.
Please.
Sir, but there are some of the creditors.
Yes, please.
Who don't have a floating charge, do not have any charge, sir.
Yes, they are unsecured creditors.
All those unsecured creditors.
Yes.
Can they appoint?
Appoint a receiver?
Yes, sir.
No, they cannot.
Okay.
A receiver can only be appointed by a secured creditor.
Very good.
Yes. It could be fixed or floating.
If
it's a fixed charge, he appoints just a receiver. A fixed charge holder cannot appoint a receiver manager because he has no business with the management of the company because his funds are ascertainable and definite. You know, and if, I mean, it's funds because of the particular asset used to secure it. And like I said, if that particular asset is jeopardized, then he would have to wait in the queue. He will have to wait in the queue until all the other secure creditors have been satisfied. But in waiting on that queue, he will still have priority over the other unsecured creditors. So he doesn't have any particular security to hold on to again. Because that particular security, let's assume it's this laptop, has now been, let me not say stolen.
It
has now been somewhere. Let me know it's my laptop. Let's assume the bag now. The bag has lost value by virtue of wear and tear. It has now become old. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And useless. That does not mean that he still doesn't have a right against the company. He does. But since this bag does not exist again, he will now have to stand in the queue behind all the other secured creditors. When they have all been paid, as against the other unsecured creditors, he will still have priority. So when we sell and liquidate the company and want to start to distribute, we'll still have to pay him first. And so probably it is to avoid such that a debenture holder will likely prefer the floating charge. Because in the event of default, he has a right to displace management and manage the company through the administrative receivership. Okay. Anyway, I'll take one more question, then we jump into dividends. If there are none, then let's move straight. I told us before that we talked about the capital structure of the company. The capital structure of the company. Again, I want to emphasize, all of you, when you finish this program, go and do ICSA, Institute of Chartered Secretaries and Administrators, if you can. The beautiful thing about it is that you can do it while you are serving. It's not like the LLM where you need to have a discharge, what? NYSC discharge certificate. So I started mine when I was doing my NYSC, and it will really open you up to this course and help you. For those of you that want to go into corporate practice, it will really, really give you a boost. I always say it's better than an LLM. You know, of course, it's a suggestion, but I strongly recommend. We have the Port Harcourt office, we have the Lagos office, and again, I say you can, if you're a chartered secretary, you can work in 94 countries with that certificate, and it's a very good boost. Okay, so let's move on. I talked about the capital structure of the company. What is the capital structure? The capital structure of a company refers to the mix of equity and what? Debt. Equity and debt. If a company is going to fund its activities through debt, then it's going to have creditors who are going to extend money to it. The company is the debtor. The person that extends the money is the creditor. Are you with me?
Yes.
Do you have a class by 10?
Yes.
International law?
No.
Yes, I swapped. So the person who is extending this money to the company is the creditor. And the primary way through which he intends to benefit from this company is called interest. It's called what?
Interest.
When we switch over to equity, the primary way through which an equity shareholder ordinarily would expect to benefit from his investment in this company is through dividends. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, so it's important to lay that foundation. But before I jump into that, thank you. No, don't worry, for you. Before I jump into that, let's look at learning outcomes. What are we looking at in this topic of dividends? At the end of this topic, you should be able to know, number one, how shareholders benefit from companies they invest in. Number one, how shareholders benefit from companies they invest in. Number two, who is authorized to declare dividends? Number three, when not to declare dividends? You should be able to know these things. Number four, you should be able to understand basic creditor protection rules as they relate to dividends. Number five, you should be able to understand what is a company's distributable profit. And lastly, you should be able to understand the rules relating to unclaimed dividends. I'll run through them again. How shareholders benefit from companies, who can declare dividends, when you should not declare dividends, what are the creditor protection rules as they relate to dividends, and what is a distributable profit, or what are distributable profits? Lastly, you should be able to understand the rules relating to unclaimed dividends. So let's start with, how do shareholders benefit from buying shares in a company? How do they benefit? And I said the primary way is through the payment of what? Dividends. Are you with me?
Yes.
But that is not the only way. That is not the only way. A shareholder can also benefit through what you call a share repurchase. A share repurchase. I bought shares from a company, 20 Naira. The company starts doing very well. And they now have excess capital. They may decide to repurchase my shares. They may say, Prosper, we are repurchasing your shares. You bought them from us at 10 Naira, but we are repurchasing it from you at 30 Naira per share. So he has benefited how much? Per
three
share,
naira.
3 Naira. Good. So share repurchase is one of the ways through which a shareholder can benefit from his shares. So share repurchase and share redemption, they are similar. Not entirely the same thing, but they are similar. The next one, he could benefit from what you call the issuance of bonus shares. Bonus shares. Are you with me?
Yes.
What is a bonus share? That my young friend, I don't know your name, the man, yes. Yes, you've never talked in this class. Stand up and let us know you. Yes. What is your name, sir?
My name is
Enako. Enako. E-N-A-T-O. Okay, Enato. So, do you know what is a bonus share? You've forgotten. I know you know, but you've forgotten.
Yes,
so,
sir.
Let me come back. Sir, I want to help him.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please, help us.
A bonus share is when everybody, when there is excess share, they just talk for every other person. Instead of going public, and I said only those people who are already
shareholders
will now give them more share. Right.
Okay, thank you. So there are two things I want you to draw a distinction between. They want to call right issues. Say right issues.
Right issues.
Then bonus share. They are different. Right. A right issue is when a company wants to sell more shares to raise money, but they decide, before we go to the public, let us first offer these shares to existing shareholders in proportion to their holding in this company. And it is mandatory for private companies. It is mandatory. You see that in Section 22 of CAMA, it is mandatory for private companies to some extent. If you are going to sell over 50% of the shares in a private company, you must first of all offer those your shares to the existing shareholders. That is actually not, strictly speaking, a right issue, you know, but a right issue is when the company now wants to raise money, but they are selling shares. First of all, they are giving you a right. A right is called a right of preemption, a right to acquire. It is when you say, please, I don't want to acquire, I have other commitments, that the company can now sell to the public or sell to another shareholder, as the case may be. Are you with me?
Yes.
A bonus share, on the other hand, is the company gifting you. When you use the word bonus, it's a gift. The company is gifting you shares in proportion to your existing shares. So we have made so much profits, we have two options. One option is to repurchase shares and give money to shareholders at a premium. So you bought it 10 naira, we are selling it to you, we are buying it back from you at 13 naira. That is a premium. I explained earlier that a premium is anything on top.
Yes, sir.
A discount is anything beneath. Yes. So that is one way. The other way is that let's give them shares free. So the company can decide, for every shareholder, for every 5 shares you have, we are giving you one bonus share. So the man who has 50 shares is probably going to get about 10 shares on top. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, and the man who has 20 shares will have maybe 4 shares on top. So that is a bonus share. That is another way through which you can benefit from being a shareholder in a company, when the company decides to issue bonus shares. Number three way, the next way, is from your own sale of your shares to a third party, in which case you are not dealing directly with the company, but you are dealing with a third party. So I have bought shares from UBA at 20 naira per share. Are you with me? UBA is doing so well on the international stock on the national stock market, and the value of the shares of UBA has risen from 20 naira per share to 35 naira per share. So I've gained that much on each share,
15
naira. I can decide to quickly cash in on that and sell. When I sell, I've made profits. In which case, the person I'm selling to now takes my place. I hands off. And so if that company is going to declare dividends, the dividends are not paid to persons, they are paid to shares. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And so the person holding those shares at that time will be the one that will benefit from them. So that is the third way through which a person can benefit from the shares he has. I hope we are clear so far.
Yes.
Kolo, are we clear? Very good. Then the primary way which we want to now look at is through the declaration of dividends. I was just trying to lay foundation. The primary way through which a person will benefit from shares that he holds is through the declaration of dividends. And dividends can be a lifetime source of revenue, particularly if the company is doing well and declares dividends annually. So it can become a lifetime source of revenue. There are persons who hold shares in companies like Dangote. I was reading yesterday that Dangote paid about 7 trillion naira dividends within the past 3 or 4 years to shareholders. So for people who own shares in a company like Nestle, the price of shares in Nestle goes for over 1,300, 1,200 naira. So for just one share. So if you have a lot of shares in Nestle, when they pay dividends, the dividends are usually high because the value of the price of the shares are also very high. You can now plan with the dividends. It can be a source of, a major source of revenue. Are you with me?
Sir,
so what are dividends? Yes, please.
For some of these companies, I don't know whether I will call it fraud. Somebody might buy shares there. And
let's
possibly
listen.
It was not given share certificate,
yes.
Nothing, no dividend for over 10 years.
Yes. I will explain. Okay, thank you. We talked about it in minority protection and a majority rule that a company, we'll talk about it. A company mustn't declare dividends, provided it is not doing that with the intention of undermining minority shareholders. It has the unfettered right not to, provided it is not. We'll talk about it briefly.
Okay,
so some issues which I just want you to note, some issues which I want you to just note, I'll run through them. Number one, in the declaration of dividends, we'll talk about what are dividends, but okay, let me not jump. What are dividends, first of all? What are dividends? So dividends are distributions. They are financial distributions paid to shareholders in proportion to their shareholding. They are financial distributions paid by the company to its shareholders in proportion to their existing shareholding. And it has been argued, or it has been said, that the acid test for whether a company has true earning power is its ability to provide a stream of dividends whose growth will keep up with inflation. I'll take it again. The acid test for determining whether a company has true earning power is its ability to provide a stream of dividends whose growth will keep up with inflation. A stream of dividends. So dividends are distributions, like I said, they are payable by the company to shareholders in proportion to what you already have. And so a company can declare and say, we are giving 2 naira per share. It could be 50 kobo per share. As they deem fit, it could be 5 naira per share. Are you with me?
Yes.
So if you have 20 naira, if you have 20 shares, and they're giving 5 naira per share, you now have 100 naira. So these are some of the distributions from time to time. But in understanding dividends, it's also important that we remember our knowledge of capital maintenance rules. And so when we look at creditor protection and dividend declaration, we need to fall back and rely on our capital maintenance rules. How are dividends paid? Literally, they are paid through the issuance, first of all, of what they call dividend warrants. When the company has finally decided to pay dividends, you know, first of all, it's the board of directors that will recommend. To ensure that there's no abuse to this process, company law has provided a two veto system, if I use that word, a two veto system. Number one, the directors must recommend. Number two, the shareholders must approve. And in approving, the shareholders can reduce what was recommended. They cannot increase. The directors must recommend. So we recommend that we pay 50 kobo per share as dividends this year. They have to table it before the members in general meeting. Who may decide to approve? Who may decide to reduce? But who cannot say increased dividends? So you discover that there's a lot of conservatism. Company law is highly conservative with respect to dividend declaration. Because if you over-declare dividends and you pay money back to shareholders and creditors have nothing to fall back on, employees don't have salaries, then we may have a problem. Are you with me? To curtail that, we have a number of rules which we'll look at presently. So I said normally these dividend warrants are meant to be posted. The company is meant to post it and by post to all the shareholders. When you get that warrant, you go to your bank. Before this time, you must have a current account. You go to your bank and pay the dividend warrant into your account. We'll talk about unclaimed dividends. Number one, we have a major problem with unclaimed dividends because of the whole of this procedure. But let me not go ahead of myself. So first of all, a dividend warrant is sent. But since the advent of technology and the internet, we have begun to move towards what you call the dematerialization of companies' securities. Dematerialization. So rather than rely on paper documents, we now hold our certificates in a dematerialized form. Are you with me so far? Are you with me so far? So what the dematerialized I'm talking about is just, it's virtual, it's on the air, it's in the computer. The company doesn't necessarily have to send you a dividend warrant, just like it doesn't have to now send you a share certificate. If you insist, they will still sell it. They will still send it to your post office box. Are you with me? But you may not visit your post office box for the next 8 months, 9 months. Sometimes when you go, you just see a pile of documents. Is it not like that? Have you not experienced that, sir?
Sure, sure.
Good. Pile of documents. You now start to go through. A general meeting, the meeting is already held, throw it away. What this one is held? Because most of the things they're even writing to you have passed. Are you with me? And so because of, to avoid all that, we have now taken advantage of the internet to say share certificates can be held in dematerialized form, and also dividend warrants, dividends can now be paid directly to your bank account.
Correct.
Yes, that is the new procedure. But for that to happen, you have to go to your stockbroker, fill a number of forms, and then when you fill those forms, your stockbroker will send it back to the registrar. The registrar will send it back to the company, as the case may be. So there's a company called the CSCS. You may want to check that out. Central Securities Clearing System, CSCS. It's more like a parastatal of the Nigerian Stock Exchange.
CS,
Central Securities Clearing System. So that company is responsible for handling and managing all of these dematerialized documents as far as the stock exchange is concerned. So now they can pay your dividends directly.
Do you know where the address is?
Their address, no, it should be in Lagos. But if you go to the Nigerian stock, just check it on the internet.
Okay, sir.
They work hand there. It's like a subsidiary of Nigerian Stock Exchange.
Okay.
Okay, so let's move on.
Sir.
Yes, please. You know, we don't have much time.
Yes, sir.
I have to finish this course by 10. Yes, so, quickly, sir.
Yeah, just like what you said, sir. I have had practical experience with it.
Yes.
When First Bank was not paying me anything,
yes,
I went to one of their branches. They said I should go to Port Harcourt,
yes,
near Gunabali there.
Yes.
They have First Bank registrar.
Registrars, yes.
As I just got there, they asked my name, and that was all.
Yes.
I was trying to tell them the year that I bought the shares, but they said no, there was no need for that.
Yes.
They now checked and saw it and apologized.
Yes.
And immediately took my bank account that I want them to be paying it.
Mm.
They paid, before I got to Baeza,
they cleared the whole backlog.
Mm. And up to today, they are still paying me my dividends.
Yes, practical. Mm-hmm. You have had the same experience too?
No.
Okay, let's rush. Please, I must finish this topic by 10 because I have a meeting and your teacher is coming. Okay, so when a company has made profits, like I said, it has a lot of funds. One of its options is to reward these faithful shareholders, particularly if the company has not paid dividends for a long time. Oando, for example, has been having a lot of problems. I have had shares in Oando. The value of my shares have fallen from 17 naira when I bought it to about 3 naira now. And I have one option I could sell and jump ship. I could decide to exercise faith with the company. If eventually Oando is able to overturn its problems and it begins to make profits again, then it will have two options. One is to declare dividends. Two, it could decide to retain funds. Are you with me? So please see section 430 of Kama. So what are retained funds? So rather than pay dividends, we may decide to retain these funds and use it to further expand the business. Or we could decide to expand, to retain some and pay some out as dividends. Let me just read what I have here for purpose of recording. So long as the firm has profitable investment opportunities open to it, the more earnings it retains and reinvests, the faster its future earnings will grow, and the larger will be its potential for the payment of future dividends. Let's rush. So, like I said, dividends must be declared by the directors and approved by shareholders. Please see sections 169 and paragraph A. See also section 426. 169 paragraph A. See also section 426.
426.
Yes, please. Again, dividend declaration. You remember we talk about ordinary business and special business? You remember?
Yes, sir.
That's my daughter. You remember what we talked about ordinary business? When we talked about meetings, who can help us? If a company is about to hold meeting, yes, sir.
If a company is about to hold meetings,
yes.
In ordinary business, they talk about declaration of dividends,
yes,
and some other normal things.
Okay.
But you have in special business, is you talk about sacking. Of or appointment.
No, second business. Special business is anything other than ordinary business.
Okay, sir,
yes. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
And we said that you can sit down. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And we said that for the special business, you must itemize in the notice.
Yes.
If you don't itemize, you can't raise it up at the meeting. For ordinary business, you don't need to itemize. All you need to say is that at this meeting, we will consider ordinary business. Look at section 238, please. Look at section 238, please. And dividend declaration is one of such ordinary matters that can routinely be concerned and considered. So you don't need to itemize it. Another thing I want to point out again is that dividends are payable not just to shareholders, but also to persons who become entitled. They are payable not just to shareholders, but also to persons who become entitled to shares. So somebody dies, all of his shares are transmitted to his son. Normally that his son is not yet a member of the company until his name is what?
Registered.
Yes, so until his name is registered, he's not a member of the company. But even as somebody who is entitled to those shares, his entitlement to be entered into the register of members also entitles him to dividends. Are you with me?
Yes.
So please look at section 1795. 179, subsection 5, please. So dividends, let me just read what I have here. Dividends are payable to shareholders and to persons becoming entitled to shares by reason of debt or bankruptcy of the original shareholder. But so you may elect, I am entitled to these shares, but I don't want my name to enter into the register of members, but I want to be getting the benefits. The law, I'm coming. The karma is saying that you should be paid those dividends. But after some time, the directors may say, Oga, choose. Either you put your name here or you don't. So if the directors now tell you, Oga, choose, put your name in the register of members or we'll stop paying your dividends. You have to put your name. If you don't, then they can withhold your dividends. Yes, my dear?
Yes, sir, you said another person can be entitled to dividends upon death and bankruptcy. I don't understand how bankruptcy.
Bankruptcy, okay, thank you. Death or bankruptcy. We talk about transmission of shares. Remember?
Yes.
Yes, transfer and transmission. Transfer is usually voluntary. Transmission is usually, not always, but usually involuntary. So if a person becomes bankrupt and he says, close your mouth, look like this. Who are you? I'm talking to him. Why are you focusing? Can we continue?
Yes, sir.
So if a person becomes bankrupt, he's unable to pay his debts, then the money that the shares he holds in the company will be transferred to his creditors. That is what we mean by transmission of shares. The court will order that your shares in UBA should be given to your creditors.
Not my shares.
No, not your shares. My daughter, is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
But on his own instruction.
No, that's why I say it's involuntary. It's a creditor. I mean, it's a debtor. He cannot pay. So the court is now ordering that all of his shares should be transferred to his creditors.
What if the court is not aware that he has shares?
That would be a different issue. You understand? And that would be a different... But once the court is aware and the court gives that order, then they will be transmitted. Please, let's move on because of our time. I'm trying to just beat around the bush before we jump in. I'm trying to just give us some of the principles. Again, note that dividends are not payable on treasury shares. Please see section 1874. Dividends are not payable on treasury shares. 187 subsection 4. 187 subsection 4. Treasury. So what are treasury shares? Treasury shares are shares that a company has reacquired. It's a new terminology you see in Kama 2020. Shares that a company has reacquired from its shareholders. You cannot pay dividends on them.
Treasury shares.
Yes, please. 187 subsection 4. Yes, share buyback is something as acquisition of shares. Yes, my daughter.
Shares repurchased. Is that what you call treasury shares? Is it the same thing?
A treasury share is a share that has been reacquired. Yes, now. You could use the word buyback. Don't take my time too much. What is your question?
You said something before about repurchase and redemption. I'll get
to the question. I said it's almost the same thing, but there could be a little bit of difference. Redemption and repurchase are virtually the same thing, but a company may have to. Redemption may be a mandatory obligation. For example, a preference share. A company is issuing a preference share to Mr. Sufi.
Yes,
sit up,
sir.
Sit properly. If a company is issuing shares to Mr. Sufi, preference share, for example, they could enter into an agreement with him. They could enter into an agreement with him that at a particular point in time, they must redeem those shares because of the obligation to pay the...
Interest.
No, not interest. The preferential dividends. You know, I said it's fixed. The fixed preferential dividends may become burdensome to the company. And the company may not want to continue with that burden. So the company may decide, Mr. Sufi, please, we are redeeming your shares. Or we are giving you an option to convert your shares to equity shares. If he converts his shares to equity shares, the company will be at liberty to pay him dividends when they want to. But if it is a preferential share, the company must pay him dividends annually. Are you with me? So that is redemption. Repurchase is the same thing, but for repurchase, the company may not necessarily be under an obligation to buy his shares, but the members may come together and say, we have made so much profit, let's repurchase shares from our shareholders. Again, Mr. Sufi may be giving us issues if we want to alter our memorandum, and he challenges us in court. Are you with me? Among other things the court could do, the court could tell us, please repurchase his shares and some of those other rules. Please, let's move on. Please see sections 144 and 169. 144 and 169 with reference again to the preferential share, which I said is fixed, ascertainable, it has priority, and the dividends for preference shares has priority over dividends for ordinary shares, equity shares. Yes. So if we have issued shares to Mr. Sufi and we have agreed to pay him his preferential dividends of 10 naira per share every year or every month, as the case may be, then until we pay him, we cannot declare dividends to pay other shareholders. Are you with me? Yes, so the preferential shareholder has a preference to dividends. He also has a preference to return of capital during winding up. So the company again is being wound up and the liquidator is going to distribute funds. The liquidator is going to distribute funds to all those who have a stake in the company. After creditors have been settled, the preference shareholder will again stand first in line before the ordinary shareholder. So please look at this sections and all that. Again, you remember that the preference shareholder has no further right to participate in dividends. You remember that?
Yes.
Yes. So his right to dividends is fixed, ascertainable. And if the company makes a bumper harvest and they are declaring greater dividends for ordinary shareholders, having been paid his ordinary, his fixed dividends, he has no further right to participate in the, of course, except the company otherwise agrees with him. Then we'll be talking about participatory preference shares. Please, let's rush because of time. Okay, section 426. Dividends could be final or interim. Final or interim. Final or interim. Interim dividends are dividends that could be paid. In between an AGM, the company may decide to pay an interim dividend. AGMs are usually held once in a year. But in between an AGM, the company may decide to still pay dividends, which is what you call an interim dividend. Please see section 426. Okay. I'm making progress. I just want to also say one or two things again about dividends and set-offs. Dividends and set-offs. Dividends and set-offs. Please just...
Sir.
Yes.
There's something you said much, much earlier at the beginning of this course.
Yes, please.
That dividends...
Yes.
Are paid after declaration of profits.
Yes.
That the company would declare profits first, and then it is after then they can now think of
paying dividends.
What percentage of the profits will be paid as dividends?
Yes, please. I said that, and now I'm coming to that now. Please, can we listen, young people? What is happening today? You are tired.
No. Abba. No. The day is still young.
Can we continue?
Yes.
Good. Okay, so please listen. Section 117, subsection 5E. Section 117, subsection 5E. Remember, we are still looking at some general rules as they pertain to dividends, and I want you to have a firm grasp of them. Section 117, subsection 5E. Okay, so if a company is liable to pay dividends to Prosper John, for example, but the shares that have been issued to this man, he has not paid for those shares to the company. Are you with me?
Yes.
So we have issued him 20 shares at 20 naira each. We have made bumper harvests, and we are declaring 30 naira for his shares. He's entitled to 30 naira as dividends, but his 20 naira he has not paid for them, for the shares we gave to him.
Yes.
Karma is saying that the company does not have the right to set off the dividends against the money it's owing. So the company cannot say, we're paying you 10 naira. That 20 naira you were owing us, Prosper, you understand, we don't collect them from these dividends. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
You don't have that right.
No, I'm not with you, sir.
That is what company law is saying.
Reaping where he didn't sow?
Yes. The reason is because even though he has not sown, as an unpaid share, as a shareholder who has not paid for his shares, he still has liability. In the event of the company being insolvent, the liquidator can still proceed against him. We talk about limited liability. And we're saying that the limited liability only applies to shareholders who have paid for their shares. Is it not so? So if we issue... and 20 shares to Mr. Prosper, and he hasn't paid for them, and we make profits, and in declaring dividends, Mr. Prosper would have been entitled to 30 naira. 30 naira. Then we don't have a right as a company to offset it, to set it off.
And is the dividends will be paid to him?
It must be paid to him. See section 117, subsection 5. Sir?
4E.
Okay, thank you for that. Section 117, 4E. Remember, if you have listened to my recordings, your emphasis in this course is not on sections, but in understanding principles.
Yes.
And, And so even if you're answering, I want to repeat it, because some of you say you have not listened to my recording. When I get feedback, somebody say, I'm not into recording. Recording is not my thing. So for those of you that recording is not your thing, let me say it in the class. If you're answering my question, and you cannot remember the section, say, Kama said. Kama said. If you cannot remember the court authority, you can say the Supreme Court said, or the court said, or it has been held. But of course, those of you who are looking for a very top A, those ones I want to intimidate, we now expect them to give us a section, and if possible, a subsection. But I will tell you this again for law school, because they also tell you law school. It will be a disservice to you to misquote the section in the exam. You will be marked down. So if you are not sure, just say section 117 or say chapter 17 deals with CVAs. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm just repeating it. So if you can understand the principle, the beautiful thing about company law is that if you can understand the principle, and that's what I'm teaching, you can stand your ground anywhere. The law can change. You can go to New Zealand, you can go to America, you can anywhere you find yourself, you will just flow. But if you are a section person, then you don't have a grasp of the principle, then you may have issues. Okay, let's move on. Our time is really, really going. So I'm saying number one, you cannot set off dividends. That is how crucial and important it is. Note, however, that even though you cannot set off dividends, the fact that he hasn't paid for his shares may be considered in the final adjustment, may be considered in the final adjustment of the rights of the members and past members among themselves during liquidation. So while the company is a going concern, Prosper has not paid for his shares. As a company, we don't have the right to set off his dividends. So if we're paying to Mr. Sufi and paying to Mr. Kolokolo, and we don't pay to him, he has a right to sue for that money, so it's his entitlement. However, if this company is now going to be liquidated and he hasn't paid for his shares, and we have funds to distribute to shareholders, are you with me? We can now factor, and that will only be during liquidation, we can now factor in the fact of his non-payment in adjusting our rights. So Kolokolo is to be paid 30 naira, Mr. Sufi is to be paid 30 naira, he is to be paid 30, but he was owing us. So we'll now pay him 10 naira. That will be during liquidation. Please, let's move on.
Okay, that is during
liquidation, yes, please. It's a going concern. Inside. You don't have the right to set off.
Full payment.
Yes, it is.
What will happen during liquidation, sir?
Sir?
You say what will happen during liquidation?
If the company is being liquidated, then we can factor in the fact that the funds he was owing us. So when we are sharing money among all the shareholders, then we can bring in that fact in adjusting the rights of shareholders among themselves. Can we continue? Note again under section 164 sub 2. Note again under section 164 sub 2. However, that a company still has a lien over dividends and bonus shares for unpaid shares. So even though we cannot set off, even though we don't have a right to set off, we still have a right of a lien. A lien, the lien is a possessory right. So we are not saying, Prosper, we are not paying you. But we are saying, Prosper, even though we cannot set off, we have a lien, so your money is with us, 20 naira is with us, but please, sir, come and pay for your shares.
What section?
Section 1 is not the same thing. Section 1642 is not the same thing, because for set-off, you are cancelling it ab initio. You are exercising the right to say, I'm owing you, but I'm not paying you. I've taken my money up front. Are you with me?
Yes.
That is a set-off. For the lien, I'm simply saying I'm holding it. It's almost the same thing. It's almost the same, but it's not the same. Again, the company has a right of lien for the unpaid shareholder, not just over dividends, but also bonus shares. So again, if we are declaring bonus shares, 2 shares for every 5 shares. When we come to Prosper, we discover that we have given him shares, but he has not paid for his shares, he's owing us. So we can again exercise a lien. So please just look them up.
So, sir, if I don't pay up, you will continue holding the shares.
Bonus. Yes. They will continue to hold it, and at some point, the company has the right to foreclose you, if you remember.
Yeah.
Foreclose him and forfeit it and sell to a third party in order to get that money. We talked about it. The company has the right to eventually foreclose him, deem those shares forfeited, sell it to another person. Mishek, I hope you're with us.
Yes, sir.
Can we continue?
Yes, sir.
Yes, so let's move on. Another thing I want you to know, section 163 sub C. Section 163 sub C. Apam, are you with us today?
Yes.
It's well, though. Section 163 sub C. You're just looking like my daughter today. Looking like my daughter. Can we continue?
Yeah.
Okay, so dividends may be paid again in proportion to the amount of paid up capital. It may be paid up in proportion. It may be paid in proportion to the amount of the paid up capital. See section 163, paragraph C. Please, let's rush. I just have less than 20 minutes and I still have about 10 slides to run through. Okay. Okay, so we want to look at limitations on payment of dividends. Limitation, yes, please. Limitation on payments of dividends. First thing I want to say is that dividends are only to be paid out of the company's distributable profits. Dividends can only be paid out of the company's distributable profits. Number two, the payment of dividends by the company is subjected to creditor protection rules as contained in CAMA. The payment of dividends is subjected to creditor protection rules as contained in the in CAMA. That's number one.
That number two.
Yeah, number two. The first one is that pay it out of distributable profits.
Yes,
number two, that right to pay is subjected to creditor protection rules. Number three, the right to pay dividends. Okay.
Right to
creditor protection rules. Can we rush?
Yes.
Good. Number three, it could also be subjected to provisions in the Articles of Association. The Articles of Association could also bind the extent to which the members can... It could also be subjected to provisions in the company's articles. You don't need to write, just get the tape. Please, let me use this 18 minutes and see what I can do. Lastly, the right to pay dividends could also be circumscribed by agreements with creditors. It could also be circumscribed by agreements with creditors. Your creditor can also put a check on you and say, don't pay dividends at all. And if you agree with him like that, you must comply with that.
Without the agreement of the shareholder?
Yes. The company is bound. If the directors acting on behalf of the company borrow money from UBA, and in borrowing that money, UBA says, until you settle us, you don't have a right to begin to share money to your shareholders.
Well, and that is crazy, man. That is debt. So they can't declare profit when they are owing. Can a company declare profit? While
yes,
owing?
Yes, of course. I'm owing you. The debt I'm owing you.
That is hypocrisy.
No. The money I'm owing you, may not have become due. I have borrowed 50,000 naira from Mr. Kolo Kolo. I'll pay him. Our agreement is that I'll pay him in 2030. I'm giving an example. Until 2030 comes, he has no business with me. We are doing transactions. We are making profits. But he has some concerns that by the time 2030 comes, we may not have anything. And so he circumscribes our right to declare dividend by saying, until 2030 comes and you settle me, all the profit you are making, keep it inside. I'm just coming down to the barest minimum to explain to us. So let's move on. Now, what are distributable profits? Please see again sections 426 and 427. I'll run through it. 426 and 427. What are distributable profits? I'll run through them. I said accumulated and realized profits of the company. 426 and 427. Please get the recording. For those of you that recording is your team, get the recording. I have to rush. For some people, recording is not their team, but I have to rush. So distributable profits are the accumulated and realized profits of the company. After deducing or after minusing or after removing, Kama uses the word less or minus, the company's accumulated realized losses. So you have made profit. First of all, remove all your losses. Is it not so?
Yes.
Whatever is left is what we are using the word as your distributable profits. In a bid to protect creditors, you will remember that we have what we call capital maintenance rules. And these rules are saying use the capital of the company only to further its business. Use the capital of the company only to further its business. Do not use this capital and return it back again to shareholders. And so it is from that principle that we have the rule against reduction of share capital. It is from that principle that we have the rule against a company acquiring its shares and against a company providing assistance for the acquisition of its shares. These three principles, these three rules are drawn from the capital maintenance principle, that at every point in time, capital must be maintained. And I told us that the primary reason is creditor protection, so that creditors can have something to fall back on. But the law gives a lot of liberty with respect to the use of distributable profits. When it comes to capital, company law changes the hands of the company and says to the company, you can only use capital to further your business. When it comes to distributable profits, what are these profits? So these are profits or outcomes from the judicious use of the capital. So if you use this capital and you make profits, you have a lot of liberty in the use of the profits, but your hands are, to a large extent, chained when it comes to capital. Are you with me?
Yes.
So, in terms of liberty in the use of and distributable profits, I want you to see section 183 sub 4A, 183 subsection 4A, and also see section 185 of CAMA. So, you can use the distributable profits to provide financial assistance for share repurchase. You can also use it for share buyback. You can see that in sections 183 and 184. Let's move on. When not to declare dividends? We are still around limitations with respect to dividend declaration. When should a company not declare dividends? Number one. Where there are reasonable grounds for believing that the company is or would be, after the payment of these dividends, unable to settle its creditors. If there are reasonable grounds for believing that after you have shared these funds, you will not have any money to pay your creditors, don't declare. And if the directors go ahead to do so, they are likely to bear personal liability. Are you with me? Number two, do not pay dividends out of your undistributable reserves. Do not pay dividends out of your undistributable reserves. Please see section 58, subsection 6. 58, subsection 6. See section 145. See section 182, subsection 4. Please, if I'm too fast, sorry. Just kindly get the recording. I apologize. I will make it available now. I'm recording audio. I'm recording video. So please, Do not pay dividends out of your undistributable reserves. Please see section 58, sub 6. See section 145. See section 182, sub section 4. See section 430. So, what are undistributable reserves? Two things. I'll just say them. Two things. Number one, share premium accounts. Number one, share premium accounts. And number two, capital redemption reserve. So don't pay dividends out of the share premium account. Don't pay dividends out of your capital redemption reserve. Are you with me so far? Again, I hope you are not laughing and mocking me. These days I'm afraid of some students. In 17 years of lecturing, I have learned to fear students. You need my feedback form? That would be great.
So that we can behave better.
I'm giving you feedback as I'm teaching. So let's move on. Some students are spies. Some, as you are teaching in class, you could say something and they have taken it to your enemies. I had a colleague many years ago, I'm on record now, who I set questions for my students in company law. He said the questions were too hard. I said it's because I taught them very well. He went to leak the questions to students. He leaked it because he was my head of department. And so I was marking. And my very weak and dull students were just doing well. I was so impressed, I called one of them. I said, my daughter, you wrote this kind of thing, I am impressed. She said, sir, it's God though, sir. I continued marking. Mr. Azubi, I now came to one of my students that I know this is the weakest. And this, my daughter was just, and this was a tough exam. I now knew that something had gone wrong. It just dawned on me that this thing has been leaked. And so I called one of my daughters. And I said, confess now. If you confess, I will protect you. If you don't confess, you will leave the school. And she confessed. She told me how it was leaked. And of course, I raised up the matter. It got to the vice chancellor. And then the VC ordered that the matter should be investigated. The lecturer was later sacked. He was sacked out of this school. So, in the course of discussing, I now told one of my students, this man leaked my question. This girl went and told him. Subai said, you leaked his question. That was over 12 years ago. From that time, I began to fear students. Let's continue. So even if you are laughing, don't laugh to the extent of mocking. Laugh small. Can we continue? Okay. So don't pay dividends out of capital. Don't pay dividends out of share premium account. Don't pay dividends out of the capital redemption reserve.
Share premium.
Yes, remember I talked about the share premium account. What is the share premium account, please? And then they help us. Please, let's listen to her. Yes.
The excess money is put into the share.
Excellent. And it's to be used for four particular things. Please note them. Note them. If a company sells shares on a premium, it is not meant to just distribute that money. Are you with me? Are you with me? That money is not to be squandered. That money, I'm coming. That money is to be kept in a special account and to be used for specific purposes. And writing of preliminary expenses, and then paying off for shares that have been issued, and bonus shares and all that. So my daughter, let me hear you quickly.
Yes, sir, you gave is it two points or three you gave.
Don't pay out of capital. Don't pay out of undistributable reserves. Undistributable reserves has two children. One is share premium account, one is capital redemption and reserve account. Let's move on. Please see section 433. Directors will be personally liable if they pay dividends out of capital. Are you with me? If directors pay dividends out of capital, they will bear personal liability to the creditors of the company. However, if the person they pay the dividends to knew that the directors were paying these dividends to him out of capital, then the director could seek indemnity from them. That is what Kama is saying. C-433, please. C-433. Okay, let's just rush through.
How is that possible?
Sir, it's possible. So, pay dividends only out of distributable profits.
Yes, sir.
Are you with me, sir?
Yes, sir.
We have capital. Don't touch the capital.
Yes.
So, if from that capital, you now pay dividends to your shareholders, you are jeopardizing the interest of creditors. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
In the event of the company having issues, those creditors can sue you, the director.
Yes.
Personally,
yes,
because the capital they would have fallen back on, you have distributed it to prosper. That's what Kama is saying.
Yes, sir.
But if they are now suing you, the creditors are now suing you, you can go back to prosper and say, that money I paid you that time, bring it back. You can only do that if prosper knew that in paying him dividends, you were violating Kama. If he did not know, then you don't have a right against him. But if he connived, if he knew, then you can be indemnified from him. So C-433, please. Let's talk briefly about unclaimed dividends. It's a very practical problem, which I want you to note. I wrote down something in my slides, which we'll see later. As at March, okay, yes. As at March 23, 2001, unclaimed dividends in Nigeria amounts to about 158.44 billion naira.
Hey.
Most of these funds belong to people who have already died. Are you with me? And I said the major reason for this was because in the past, you have to send this thing by post. Some people don't have post office address. Some people, the postman cannot even locate where they are staying. He says, send it to Swale, the house behind Chief Kilovie's house. That is where you bring my dividend. Who is Chief Kilovie? The postman comes and looks for Kilovie in Swale, he cannot find it, he throws it somewhere. So all of these warrants have become wasted. Are you with me? Because people have not gone to claim their funds. So the funds are still trapped somewhere. The federal government of late is seeking to fund budget from unclaimed dividends. How many of us heard about it? Good. You heard of it?
But my money is there.
Your money is there, my money is there too. So there's a website, I think, if I remember, I'll send you the link.
Okay, sir.
Where you click your name, you will see the companies and the funds owing. So I clicked my mother's name, I could not see. I clicked one of my relatives' name, old man, 80-something years, different companies that, you know. Again, why don't people go to claim this dividend? Because sometimes these funds are very small.
Yeah, yes.
A company could send you a dividend warrant and 340 naira.
Yeah.
And the time you use to go to UBA and come, the money is wasted, isn't it also?
Yes.
So, but when you accumulate everything, you now amass it for people in the country, discover that it has run into billions. So there's a problem with unclaimed dividends, which I want you to know. So what has Kama said about unclaimed dividends? Quickly. Please see sections 429 and 432. Sections 429 and 432. Number one, Kama is saying, publish the list. My son, is this thing working?
Yes.
Good. Publish the list of unclaimed dividends in two national newspapers. Publish also the names of all the persons entitled to these dividends. Secondly, when you are sending out notice of general meetings to all your shareholders, send this list, as well as the names to those persons who are entitled to these dividends so that they will know. So publish it on the newspaper, at least you have done your part. Then when you are calling for meetings, still send the notice or the list. Apam, Tamara what?
Tamara.
Good, Apam, Tamara Crow, 50,000 naira you have not gone to take, and you are here complaining for money. Your money is waiting for you. Send the list when you are giving her a notice. That's what Kama is saying. And after 3 months of doing this, if APAM does not come to collect our money, the company is now allowed to reinvest it.
Yeah.
Are you with me?
Yes.
The company is now allowed to reinvest it and start using it. And in using it, the company is not obligated to pay our interest. APAM cannot come later and say, you use my 50,000 naira, now you have made more profits, give me the interest. So she can only come back and claim her 50,000. But whatever we have profited from now belongs to us. So please look at this in 429 and 432.
And it's after 3 months.
Yes, sir. In she doesn't come. However, she can claim interest, 429 sub 3. She can claim interest if the company sends dividends to Prosper, and through no fault of hers, they did not send dividends, they warrant to her. It could be her fault if she gave them a wrong address. Is it not so?
Yes.
Yes. But through no fault of hers, they did not notify her. Then if you pay him dividends, then you have to pay her dividends and pay her interest as well. So please note that. Lastly, 432 sub 2. After 12 years, unclaimed dividends are now to become part of the company's distributable profit so that everybody can eat it. After 12 years, if APAM does not come to collect the money belonging to her, then the company can now say, remember, before 12 years, the company could only use it to trade, but they did not have to pay her interest. Once the 12 years is over, that money is now everybody's money. Please notice. I'm almost done. Bear with me. Okay. Thank you, Lord. Okay, see section 432, 430, section 430, subsection 1, and then subsection 2, reserves and capitalization. Reserves and capitalization. I already talked to Ross about retained earnings. These days, I'm afraid to ask you people questions so that you not say, when you ask me a question, that my heart is beating. That, my daughter, what is your name again?
Queen Bestman.
Eh? Queen Bestman. Bestman, yes. So, you can sit down. So, I just want to say something briefly.
Just 1 minute.
Yes, please.
Is it possible now for me to go to court?
Yes.
That this company has not paid me for the past 12 years?
Yes.
And then court orders that they should pay me because it was not my fault?
Yes.
And pay me with interest?
And if it wasn't your fault, I want to believe the court in its equitable jurisdiction should be able to. If it wasn't your fault. You understand, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, because it's a debt due. It's a debt due. But again, some statute of limitations may apply. I need to look at the rules. You understand? We have what they call statute of limitation. And it depends on the particular state. It depends on it. Maybe 5 years as the case may be. There must be an end to litigation. Is it not so?
Yes.
But other than that, I want to believe within that 12 years, and he should still have a right. So I talked about distributable profits. The company has made profits, they can decide to distribute. In distributing these profits, they could decide to retain some. What they retain, they can plow back into the business. But what they retain, they can decide not to plow into the business necessarily, but to transfer to a particular, to the company's reserves. To the company's reserve. So let me read section 431. The directors may, prior to declaring or recommending dividends, set aside profits of the firm, which may be used for any purpose for which the profits may be applied, or may employ same in the business of the firm, or may be invested other than in shares of the firm, as the directors may from time to time think, and blah, blah, blah. So section 430, subsection 1, deals with retained earnings. But subsection 2 now deals with capitalization. The company has made profits. It can decide, rather than share this money to shareholders, it can decide to capitalize it. Are you with me? Once it capitalizes it, the company's hands are chained. All the rules relating to capital maintenance will apply to that money. I'll take it again. The company can retain the money and use it to do his business, do anything they want to do with it, rather than share it to members. That is 430 subsection 1. 2, it can retain the money and capitalize it, in which case it has increased its capital base. It has increased its capital base. And once it does that, all the rules of KAMA relating to the use of the capital, like reduction of share capital and all that, will apply. And again, the purpose for that is shareholder protection. So please look it up. See 430 subsection 2. Please look it up. Lastly, okay, so, and what Mr. Sifi was asking, see, for 432, there's dividends are deemed to be special debts due and recoverable by shareholders within 12 years. Within 12 years. So that is within a 12-year period. After 12 years, I want to believe it should be statute barred. Employees and dividends and profit sharing, section 431. I talked about an employee share scheme in this class. Bekowe, can you help me? What is an employee share scheme? Richard is not coming to fly. We'll just show his face one day. I will not see him. The class fund president, that fair young man, okay? Tell them. He'll just show his face and move. I will cite them for contempt. Contempt of lecturer. Tell all of them. Annabelle and Best, both of you, I nearly cited you for contempt. You were conspicuously absent. But I pardon you for now.
No, she yes, was sir. Sick, terribly sick.
Who was sick?
Annabelle was sick.
Are you sure?
Yes, sir.
Are you sure? This girl that was doing something else.
No, sir. No.
Leave him. Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Let me hear you quickly. I'm done.
Sir, sometimes the company may decide to reward hardworking staff and may not.
Please let's listen to him.
Equity shares.
Yes, please.
You did say so.
Yes.
Time ago.
That's the employee share scheme.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You reward them with shares.
Yes.
So that is the.
That is the employee share scheme. Excellent. You want to ask?
I have a question.
Yes, please. Yes, sir.
You said something about 3 months that they are not able to claim dividend within 3 months.
Yes.
To be regarded as dormant. And now you said
regarded as what?
To be regarded that it did not grow.
No, no, not that. The company can start to use that money to do its business. But if
no,
in using the money,
no
APAM suddenly comes, so say that money you are now using to do business is my own, though. The company is to pay her, but they will not pay her interest. So if that 50,000 naira that belongs to her has now generated 1 million naira profits, what they will just give her is her 50,000. If, however, they omitted to pay her dividends through no fault of hers,
yes,
then they would have to pay her interest. But the idea is that, APAM, we went to national newspaper, we sent you your dividend warrant, the last notice of meeting we called, we even attached the document to you, you have still not come to take your dividend, so we can't keep the money here, we are using it for business. But now let me talk briefly about employee share scheme and profit sharing. So, two ways through which a company may decide to reward its shareholder. Please sit up, that my daughter. That girl behind. Yes, sit up. I'm almost done. Good. So the company wants to reward the shareholders, the employees. One of the ways they could do, like Mr. Sufi is saying, is to institute an employee share scheme and issue shares to these employees. So whenever the company makes profits and declares dividends, the employees also profit. And I told us the intention for this is to align the interest of the employees with the interest of the company. If, for example, NDU was doing such, maybe some lecturers would have been more serious. But now, whether students are doing well or they are not doing well, my salary is paid, is it not so? So, for company, they try to align the interest of the company with the interest of the employee. That is one of the ways to do that. The other way they can do that, they may decide not to issue shares. Please listen. They may decide not to issue shares, but they could make a commitment to the employees that out of whatever we make as profit, we are giving you a percentage. Out of whatever we make as a profit, we are giving you a percentage. If the company now makes profit and then doesn't declare a dividend, are you with me? And doesn't declare a dividend, the employees will still have a right to proceed against the company. Secondly, even if there is a share scheme, an employee share scheme that the company has entered into with its employees, and the company decides not to declare dividends, so we have made profits this year, we have made next year, and we have made the year following, and we have issued shares to all our employees, saying that when we make profit, we'll give you this amount of money as dividends.